morning.
Good morning.
Our opening hymn is number 567. Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins.
His mercy endures forever.
On page 352, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By all we have done. God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Amen.
First lesson, a reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones, and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord." So I prophesied as I had been commanded, and as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, "Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, Thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live." I prophesied, and he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived, and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, "Mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore, prophesy, and say to them, Thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord, when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, has spoken and will act, says the Lord." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Paul's letter to the Romans. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, you are in the spirit, since the spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the spirit is life because of righteousness. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his spirit that dwells in you. The word of the Lord.
Praise be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother, Lazarus, was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble, because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble because the light is not in them." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was merely referring to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us go also, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world. When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when Mary heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house consoling her saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" He said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, there's a stench, because he's been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. Angry. When I knew she was nearing death, I had God could handle it. I knew that God could handle my railing at him and saying, this isn't fair. This is not someone who should be dying. She has a family to take care of. She's a doctor, for crying out loud. She's a business. She has children who are so little, and they're not going to know their mom. And I was mad. I'm still kind of mad. But I also, as a priest, know that we all get mad when someone dies periodically, and that we all have to struggle through that, and that in those moments, as people of faith, as people who believe in the resurrected Christ, that death leads to resurrection, leads to new life. So when I read this, the first Sunday I'm preaching, after taking 2 months off of preaching after the death of our friend, I am humbled and I'm feeling the humanity of Mary and Martha in that frustration. Jesus, if you had been here, he wouldn't have died. If you had been here. We called you, you didn't come. Sometimes it feels like our prayers don't get answered. This story shows us that our prayers can be answered, and that they are answered, and that God is present with us. If we are in a relationship with God, and we understand that relationship with God as being something deeply embedded in who we are. My friend, the Reverend Lindsay Harding Freeman, is a book writer, and she has written a couple books. I don't know. And some of you may be familiar with them. One is called The Scarlet Cord, Conversations with God's Chosen Women. And the other one is Bible Women, All Their Words and Why They Matter. A collection of people from Trinity Episcopal Church in Excelsior, Minnesota, where I was raised up, got together and put together this book by looking through every single word in the Bible and finding every word that women said. And she wrote this book, The Scarlet Cord, which highlights a few of the women and tells their story in a new way, helping us to understand their purpose in Scripture. And the stories of Mary and Martha in here are very powerful. They might be a little creative, but they are powerful tools for us to understand, particularly today's gospel, and how women can respond to the death of their brother and how their relationship with Jesus, because it was strong, because Jesus had come to them a few years, maybe not a few years earlier, but at some point in his ministry, bringing all the guys into their house, and Martha goes and she cooks all that food, and Mary just sits there and listens, we get to hear how they might have felt, why they felt that way. But as a part of it, it helps us understand the deep relationship that these women and Lazarus had with Jesus. And I think it makes it easier for Mary and Martha, because they have this tight bond with Jesus, to say, you weren't here, and I'm mad at you because you weren't here. But I know that there's a resurrection. I know that you are Jesus. You are God's son. And Martha says it plainly in this gospel. She plainly says, you are the Messiah. She is the first person in Scripture that says that. She, not he. I love you, men. But it's important to recognize that sometimes the strongest responses to Jesus come from the least expected people. So I want you to think about how your relationship with God, with Jesus, with the Holy Spirit, gives you the strength and permission to be mad at God or to go to God with your choice and your thanksgivings, and to know that whether it's in your frustration and your anger or if it is in the best of times, that God is present with you. You are in relationship with God. earlier this week about relationships, and that we're going to take some time now, as me as your new rector and Jeff as the rector's spouse, to get to know one another. And it's and so we have time now to get to know one another and be maybe not as tight as Jesus and Mary and Martha and Lazarus, but to give us an opportunity to get to know one another, to tell our stories, to live in community together, to be a part of St. James and Pelee Valley and the greater Louisville area, and become stronger messengers of God's love to the world. And I'm hoping that we can do that together. That's why I came here, so that we can do that together. So thank you for being here on this first Sunday of my rectorship here at St. James, Pelee Valley. And I thank you for the opportunities that are to come and the times that we're going to have to get to know each other and be in relationship with one another. Thank you again.
Trust, especially Joe, our president, Andy, our governor, that they may
serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person. We pray to you, O Lord.
Give your grace.
For all who live and work in this community, especially Oldham County and all surrounding counties, we pray to you, O Lord.
Give your grace.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and for all who suffer, especially for those on our prayer list, Bobby, Francisco, Jack, James, Lisa, Stephanie, Susan, Tom, Trey, Virginia, and for those who have received our healing blankets, and for all refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord. For this congregation, for those who are present, and for those who are absent, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord. For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health, we pray to you, O Lord. For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that, with all the saints, they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord. Rejoicing in the fellowship of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, blessed James, and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our Lord. To you, O Lord.
Hasten, O Father, the coming of your kingdom, and grant that we, your servants who now live by faith, may with joy behold your Son who is coming in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. But I really hear the story, because so much happens from in that time. The farewell discourse that Jesus gives us in the book of John is so full and rich and teaches us so much about his relationship. Here's that word again. His relationship with his disciples. And ultimately, that conversation that he's having with the disciples is with us. And so to hear that is really important. You get to hear a part of that on Monday, Thursday. So this is my big invitation to please have you come on Monday, Thursday for worship. We will wash feet. I know that's not a thing for some people. Some people don't like to take off their shoes and socks in front of other people and have somebody touch their feet. That's okay. Come anyway. You don't have to have your feet washed. Though at some point in your life, I hope you do, because there is something very humbling about that experience. Deacon Mary will be back and for that service. So we'll have a partnership of our clergy here to do that service with you. Following the liturgy of Monday, Thursday, with the altar nails strip the altar. Because at that point, Jesus has walked into the Garden of Gethsemane and has started to walk his way and be arrested, and it's the Last Supper. So we clean the space where we have it. It's powerful, and it's very pivotal in our time. We finish all of the communion. We have no reserve because Jesus will die and there is nothing for us to have until he is risen again. Friday at 12:15, we will have the Good Friday service where we will again read the story of the Passion. We'll read it from John. I believe it's John that we're reading it from. All the Gospels have their own way of telling the story. John tends to be the one that we do on Good Friday. On Saturday, there's also going to be stations of the cross on Friday evening and Saturday evening. So you can come and walk the stations with Mary. On Saturday, the Altar Guild will gather around 9 a.m., correct? And they will set up this place and make it very fragrant with lilies and changing colors to light and decorating the space for Easter Sunday. At 10 o'clock, we will have very brief service. It's actually liturgy in your Book of Common Prayer for Holy Saturday, where we actually take a few minutes to realize that Jesus spent time in a tomb. What does that mean? So we'll talk a little bit about that, and then the choir may or may not have a choir rehearsal so that they can sing very, very fabulously on Easter morning for all of us. That 10 o'clock service is open to Altar Hill. It's open to choir members. It's open to you. So if you want to come and spend 15 minutes or so in worship. I don't know if it's going to be in here. It might be in the parish hall, in Gleason Hall. We might want to reserve all the beauty of the Easter Day stuff for Easter Day. So that is what's happening. The Easter service, of course, is at 10 a.m. That Sunday. And it is the time for us to dig out that word that we haven't been saying and shout it very loudly. Celebrate the risen Christ. So this is my invitation to you to participate in not just the Holy Lent that we've just been walking through, but this Holy, Holy Week. Join with me and share with me and experience with me some of that time and experience it with one another. And if you feel so moved, to take off your socks and your shoes and get your feet washed. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, a perfect offering and sacrifice to the whole world. right and the good and joyful thing always and everywhere. Thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace we are able to triumph over every evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Spirit, all honor. 65, let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, may you have graciously accepted us as the members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us out into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and to serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord.
Unfortunately, we had to cancel our third pasta dinner freezer full of food that we can have for another event. It's not scheduled yet, but I'm sure it'll be a lot of fun, and it will be delicious. So we'll wait to hear from that. Besides, Debbie talked about Holy Week, but we do have this Wednesday our final mentor program on Wednesday evening. So if you can, we'd love you to join us 5:30 for stations, 6 o'clock for soup and salad, and the fourth lesson from Joe, John, and Mike Owens on the history and theology of Lent, Holy Week, and the Resurrection. Also, don't forget to pick up your food bags in the back. It is next Sunday, April 2nd, is the first Sunday of the month, and that is when we take our donations. There's data back there, bags. We take our donations to Red Cross food banks, so please remember to bring those in so we can, they can be blessed and we can deliver them to those in need. Yes?
We're going to gather through Friday because they have some personnel issues at the Red Cross. So if for any reason you forget it Sunday, we'll be looking for the rest of the week.
Okay, we're good. Thank you. Judy said that the Red Cross has had some various issues, so they will be collecting the food donations for a little longer than just Monday. So if you have anything to bring in, can't bring it in next Sunday, but you're coming in for various services during Holy Week, bring those bags in, and on Friday, Good Friday, they will be delivered to the Red Cross. Gives us a little bit extra time in case we forget. Our next family service project will be on Saturday, April 1st, the Saturday before Palm Sunday, because that project will be to make the palm crosses. That's always a lot of fun. I don't know if you've ever done that or not, but if you have children that want to help, or if you want to just come in and help, that will be at 9 a.m. in Gleason Hall on Saturday, April 1st, palm crosses. And then also next Sunday, after our Palm Sunday service, we're going to have a formal welcome reception for Reverend Debbie and Jeff. So please make plans to attend that if you can. It should be a lot of fun. Anybody else have anything else to add?
I do.
Okay.
Can I take a
shortcut? Sure. Absolutely.
So I wanted you to know that St. Albans wants to give you a gift. And so they have a little box here that they decorated from St. Albans to St. James. And I wanted to present this to you as a gift from our Peace Garden at St. Albans for here to utilize if we so can. I'm so inclined to do that. So if I
Oh, it's seeds.
Oh. it's sunflower seeds. We had some of the gorgeous sunflower seeds in that garden, and they wanted to show them here at St. James as a gift from St. Albans. So I want to make sure that I made that really a big deal at the end of the service.
Scheduled to practice right after our service. So if we can take our conversations over at Gleason Hall, it will help them to be able to go ahead and get started on practicing for those, that wonderful service that we have coming up on Palm Sunday at Easter. So appreciate that. Yes. Easter candy, yes. Basket in the bag. I haven't checked it this morning, but I know last week there were already some bags of candy in there. But we will be having the Easter egg hunt after our Easter service, following